Okay, so yeah, it's just gone two. So yeah, welcome everyone online and in person to this is the final in-person ATM seminar, and I believe also the final analysis seminar. And so we've joined forces on a non-typical day to bring you a Thursday special edition joint seminar. And today we've got the pleasure of welcoming David Schaefer from Duke University to Cardiff. He's visiting me this week, visiting Edinburgh next week, and then we're going together as well to Manchester on a grand tour of science. And here's the first stop with a public audience. Dave is Emeritus Professor of Mathematics at Duke. He's been professor at Duke since the 70s, 78. Yeah. And before that, at Duke and then at MIT before that. So yeah, a very distinguished career in topics related to the theories of PDEs. I think you've written books on PDE analysis theory as well. I believe David started in granular flow and went away and did some modeling in biological systems, especially related to heart rhythms. But here he is back telling us how he's resuscitated his granular flow modeling. So away to you, Dave.
Oh, thank you, Tom. It's a pleasure to be here. I've been here in Cardiff for the better part of for a week and enjoying myself very much after some wandering around trying to find my way. But I've learned the way, at least from my hotel to the university. Oh, please tell me if I'm not speaking loud enough. Honestly, I retired in 2012 and it's been 10 years since I gave any lectures. This may seem like a self-deprecating title, but honestly, I consider it as a license to talk about myself for an hour with a captive audience. So thank you. I worked in various kinds of analysis for about 20 years before I got turned on to granular flow. What happened was in the mid-80s, I was visiting the University of Houston, and I was giving lectures there for a week. I had a lot of free time in my hand, and the people in the math department said, hey, there's this guy in chemical engineering who says he wants to talk to a mathematician. And I had spare time, so I went in there and talked to him. It was Roy Jackson. I learned later he's one of the superstars in chemical engineering. It was obvious that he was a very smart person. And he turned me on to this problem of the flow of random materials in a hopper. It's more or less the same as flow of sand in an hourglass. Just about every paper in granular flow begins with half a page listing all the applications of granular flow, most of which are geophysical, like landslides, avalanches, beach erosion, soils. I retained a special fondness in my heart for the original application of silos and hoppers. Can you see this bottom line? And there's a factoid that you might find interesting. The probability of the collapse of a silo is about 1,000 times greater than the probability of other buildings collapsing. Things happen in a silo that they don't really understand. And when a big coal silo collapses, you've got a lot of mess on your hands. I say I was seduced because it appeared that there was some new physics as well as some new math in this field. At the time, people were saying, physicists, that granular flow is kind of like a new state of matter, neither a liquid nor a solid. It can flow like a liquid, but it can also sustain shear stress, even at rest. In a hopper, the exit speed here is largely independent of the head. Unlike with a fluid, if you had a larger head, the material would be coming out faster. But with the silo, frictional material, a lot of the weight is carried by the walls, and in fact, the stresses go to zero. the pressure in a hopper increases its height up to it. Goes back to zero here. But initially, the pressure increases again, exactly the opposite of what's good. And friction, a lot of this unintuitive behavior is related to the fact that friction is independent of velocity. And an interesting illustration of this was when mechanical plows were introduced on farms. People thought that, well, if I have a plow that's moving three times as fast as a horse, I'm going to need more force on the plow. But it turned out not to be true. Once you have enough force to overcome friction, the extra force needed to go faster is not that great. So the new math that turned on is that although we're talking about steady state equations, they're hyperbolic, like the wave equation. Usually for a hyperbolic equation, you have an initial value problem, but here it's a steady state problem. And so my hope was that, oh, this is going to suggest new boundary conditions for hyperbolic equations, different from the standard initial value problem. And I'll have this physical application to guide me as to what they should be. Well, to put some flesh on those bones, I've got to go into a little bit into the mathematics. The unknowns are in the system, let's say two-dimensional, keep it simple. So following a wedge, the velocity vector, and the stress tensor. The minus sign is because compressive stresses are considered positive. Normally the stresses would be negative. So in order for the pressure to be a positive quantity, I need to put in the minus sign. I subtract off the multiple of the identity to form a traceless tensor, the so-called shear stress tensor. Norm is measured for the size. And in the usual continuum mechanics way, I define the strain rate tensor as the symmetric part of the velocity gradient. Just to illustrate this, let me consider so called simple shear, one dimensional motion in which all the motion is in one direction, but the speed at which it moves depends on the XQ coordinate and the normal coordinate. In that case, the shear strain tensor would be this matrix. And from that, I'd like to construct the invariant, which is the derivative you want, and that's the shear strain rate. Remember that quantity because it's going to come up later. So, governing equations in any continuum system, of course, I have my conservation laws, conservation and momentum. with MA, but I'm neglecting inertia because typically the flow in these hoppers is very slow. So this perhaps is better called stress balance. Sigma is the internal forces in the continuum. It's like the pressure, except that it's direction dependent, the pressure in different directions. Of course, that's only two equations for five unknowns, and I need to supplement with constitutive laws. Really. The simplest constitutive law is to just assume that material is incompressible. The yield condition, well, I've got an inequality here. And the yield condition does say that the amount of shear stress is less than or equal to this constant times the pressure. Just like in a block sliding on friction, the amount of tangential or horizontal force is less than or equal to a constant times the normal force. But if it's actually sliding, then we have equality. In the case of brand new materials, the tangent of this number of mu, or the inverse tangent of this number of mu, is the so-called angle of internal friction. And if the slope is less than the angle of internal friction, you can have a stable pile. But if it's greater than that, there's no equilibrium equation going to be solution. So the yield condition becomes an equation if material is actually slowing. Unfortunately, there are applications where that's not true. It's not true. For example, in a silo with a flat bottom, material comes out the center of the hole, but the stagnant regions to the side. And these equations are indeterminate in that region. And then the third constitutive equation is the alignment condition. And the next slide talks about that. The equation requires that the eigenvalues of this eigenvectors of the strain tensor, stress tensor, and strain rate tensor are aligned. And the idea behind that is, well, here I have my stress is non-direct pressures that vary with direction, and I suppose that the two eigenvectors are shown. And in response to a large compression in one direction and not so large compression in the other, the material will compact in the highly squeezed direction and usually expand in the other direction. That's not necessarily the case, but that's usually true. So to express this in equations, let me write tau, and that was the traceless part of the stress tensor. So symmetric. Traceless is the norm of tau times this matrix, which has eigenvalues plus or minus one. And this equation defines the so-called Sokolowski variable psi. It tells you the orientation of the stress vector with respect to the x. So here's the stress tensor. Here's the strain rate tensor, and these are supposed to have the same eigenvectors, which means the matrices have to be proportional. And to be proportional, the cross product of this first row with that first row has to be equal to zero. Then the cosine 2 psi times the second entry here has to be equal to the sine of 2 psi times the second entry there. The second rows have to be proportional too, but because of the fact that the strain rate tensor is divergence free, or here this relation, the second equation gives the same, the second row gives the same equation as the first equation. So I claim these equations are hyperbolic, even though they're steady state equations. Here I've written the equations. That first equation you've actually seen is just this equation that says that the divergence of the stress tensor is rho times g1. But I've written that sigma is minus p times the identity plus tau. And I've used the fact I've written tau in terms of the Sokolowski variables. And I've replaced the magnitude of tau by mu times p. So these are the conservation laws as the divergence free equation, and there's the alignment condition. I satisfied the yield condition just by the definition of the Sokolowski variables. So I want to claim that this is a hyperbolic system. Well, let me separate it into two by two systems. One, the fourth equation for the velocity, and the equations of stresses, let me consider the velocity equations. These equations are non-linear. And in order to assess the type of the equation, I want to freeze the coefficients. And freezing the coefficients in this means it's psi. But psi is just an angle. And if I rotate my coordinates to align with psi, I can arrange that psi is equal to zero. This frozen psi is equal to zero. And if I replace psi by zero, these equations simplify down to this pair, the equations for the velocity. And maybe you can look at that and say, oh yeah, that's the wave equation written as the first order system. Or maybe not. So let's actually show that. Equations are hyperbolic if there exists bounded exponential solutions. For an elliptic equation, the definition of ellipticity is there are no such solutions. That if you plug this into the equation, you end the equation with a zero, like the velocity equation. So exponential times a constant vector. Let's substitute that into our equations. The divergence equation gives us the inner product with the wave number c. Second equation is something like the cross product. Do these two equations have a non-trivial solution, A1, A2? Well, let's use our linear algebra. I can write this as this coefficient matrix times A1, A2. Is there a non-trivial solution of this equation? Well, there is a non-zero solution only if this matrix is simple, i.e., only if the determinant vanishes. And of course, there are two such solutions, C1 equals plus or minus C2. There are two independent directions in which there exist bounded exponential solutions, so 2x2 system. So the system is hyperbolic. So these two directions happen to be 45 degrees with respect to the principal axes of the stress tensor. I did think in the coordinate system, which is along with the stress vectors, I go to the general system. The stress equations are also hyperbolic, but a little messier analysis, but fine, it's never there. The honeymoon's over. The catastrophe that I ran into happened when I started trying to put the dynamics for what's called the Coulomb material, what we've been talking about. Coulomb's paper was in 1776, and he was analyzing the stability of earthen fortifications. Introduce some of these ideas. So these are the same equations before, except I put it in the acceleration term because I'm looking at dynamics. Really, I should have the convective derivatives, the non-linear term, but for small velocity, that's not very important. Not really about the same. It's just a equation. In analysis of ill-posedness, one plays a pretty similar game. Seek exponential solutions in which you have bounded exponential solution in space and ask for what lambdas is in such a solution. Lambda is the growth rate. How big do these solutions grow? This leads to a generalized eigenvalue problem. And the horrible fact that I came across in 1987 was that the maximum of the growth rates is infinite. That's what we mean by ill-posedness, linearly ill-posed. The precise result may be a little bit technical, and so let me illustrate what's going on with the scale of the analog. The mixture of the forwards and backwards heat equation with a linear term that I describe as the heat path. A linear term with in the absence of spatial dependence, we would call it the path. And I want to look for solutions of that same form, bounded exponential in space times exponential growth in time, and it can be real or complex. And in order for this equation to be satisfied, when I differentiate on the left, I bring out lambda. When I differentiate on the right, twice as quick as S1, each time it brings down a factor of RC, the two factors of RC minus C squared. That's the sort of decay you would expect from an ordinary heat equation. This backwards heat equation term gives me a plus C squared. That's rapid growth. And then C just causes it there. So if I ask myself, what's the behavior of lambda as a function of C1 and C2? Inside the hyperbola, lambda is positive. And along any radial line, which is inside this wedge, the wedge by the dotted line, inside the wedge, as B goes to infinity, in other words, plane waves in certain directions are amplified in directions inside the wedge, but plane waves outside that wedge, yeah. So it's a directional dependent phenomenon. Neil Posidonis is bad news for the theory. There are some people who say that maybe Neil Posidonis is okay because discontinuities develop under in some circumstances in granular material. And here I'm indicating a circumstance under which discontinuities develop. This is the so-called biaxial test. Material is compressed in one direction and allowed to expand in the other. And if the material is over-consolidated, this tensor you get shear transform. That is, the discontinuity develops, and there's a tendency for the motion to reduce to two rigid blocks sliding over one another along this plane. The block on the left, the block on the right, moving to the left, the block on the left, moving up. And there are experiments in which they do this. I don't support the idea that Neil Posidonis is okay because there are two very bad consequences of Neil Posidonis. One is the solutions of an initial value problem almost never exist unless you have extremely special initial conditions. And the other is if you try to solve the PDE numerically, your answer depends on how fine you choose to do it. Let me try to illustrate both of those. The existence problem. So let me consider the backwards heat equation with this heat bath. Say, just on a standing interval from 0 to pi, with initial conditions, I've chosen that function. 1 plus cosine, that's the shape. And let me raise it to the power of p. A non-integer power. I claim this initial value problem doesn't have any solution, no matter how small the time is, unless p is an even integer. Why? What's going on? If p is not an even integer, there's a mild singularity here. All derivatives of order less than p, and p could be 1,000, 1,500. All derivatives of order less than that are bounded and continuous. All derivatives greater than that are bounded. So this equation has these initial conditions have a singularity. So let's prove the claim. Here's my equation, my initial conditions, boundary conditions. So let's solve it by separation of variables. If I combine the equations and the boundary conditions, I get a series in terms of the eigenfunctions, cosine and x, with time dependence, lambda is equal to n squared minus c, that's the lambda from these in this equation. So in order to solve the initial value problem, I need to choose these coefficients so that the time zero. At time zero, I get my initial condition. But since this is a singular, these are singular initial conditions, the the coefficients decay only algebraically as n goes to infinity. As I've set it up, they decay like 1 over n to the p plus 1 power. So in this theory, if t is positive, these exponentials go like e to the n squared, but completely solves the algebraic decay of the coefficient. But there's no solution. The series diverges no matter how small the positive t may be. So no solution. Why are the grand points? I wish the hell I could tell you. I have not been able to find a good intuitive reason. The only thing I've been able to do is the result of calculations. And they're messy calculations. Many people have checked them. I've used it right. But why can't we think of it? Oh, it's because blah, blah, blah. Well, I don't know why. So that was the first problem of Bill Posen. The second was the grid-dependent computation. I don't want to get lost into numerical analysis. So let me just consider a numerical approximation of the previous value with grid size, the spacing between grid points delta y. The numerical solution has almost the same behavior as a finite Fourier series of the type that we have to write truncate terms. N is less than or equal to 1 over the grid length. The smaller the grid size, the more terms I get. So if delta y is too large, specifically bigger than 1 over the square root of c, then for all of the n's that are in that sum, the growth rate is actually negative. So if I have a delta y, which is on the large side, the numerical solution will decay. So if you're on a computer and you've got some messy system, you can't see what's going on, you would say, hey, this looks like a good problem. It decays to zero. But the numerical scheme fails to converge, delta y goes to zero, because once n gets bigger than, little n gets bigger than that cutoff, you start getting exponentially growing terms, and the computer solution will blow up. And the smaller you choose delta y, the worse it gets. So if c happens to be pretty large, but you really have to make it pretty small before you begin to see the real positiveness. So, if in a complicated problem where it's expensive to refine your grid, you might stop at some intermediate level of refinement and say, hey, this is okay. Well, that flies under, may fly in a physics department, but it doesn't fly in a math department. What does the partial differential equation mean if the solution doesn't actually, if the different scheme doesn't actually have a meaning?
Because you've got to see.
Capital C is a term that I stuck in there for the heat equation. It's certainly not obvious that this kind of phenomenon is in the granular solar equation, but in fact we find that it is. So it's a decay at the from zero order terms. So I felt stuck, and I tried any number of alternative theories. I'm going to talk about two of them, which we go all the way. The first is so-called string hardening, in which the yield condition is modified, and instead of being a constant quantity, the constant which increases as strain occurs. The derivative of gamma, we have this quantity gamma. never thought before. It was a spring lake. And so gamma is the cumulative energy. Well, it helps. It delays the onset of GoPros in this. Typically, this mu of gamma increases in this sort of curve with asymptotes. But sometimes, alpha micros GoPros in this sets in. You delay it, but you don't eliminate it. The second alternative that I investigated is a critical state of soil mechanics. This is a theory in the Schofield and Ross, which you allow the material to be compressible. And when the material is compressible, you need the density of the sixth variable. Well, that's usually represented by choosing phi to be the solids fraction, where the actual density rho is the density of the solid grain times phi. If the solid fraction, if half the volume is occupied by particles, then the density would be half of the density of a solid grain over 3 kilometers of water. So one has to expand the system slightly. And two equations are owing mostly F2 equation, which is conservation of mass or the continuity equation. And two of the equations are modified. The first is the yield condition depends on density or solid fraction. And this is a very clever theory that they choose this yield function that's dependent on density in just such a way that the Coulomb material emerges as an asymptotic limit. It's very clever. I could spend the lecture trying to explain it, and it still might not be clear because it takes to absorb it, but there it is. And then I also changed the flow rule because material no longer compressible, but divergence is tied to the shear rate by function of these variables. Shear drives volume change. And this captures what Reynolds, back in the 19th century, called dilation signal. If you have material which is very compact, then you shear it. In order for it to have room to deform, it has to expand somewhere. Or conversely, if it's loose and you shear it, it's F tells you. So this is the Reynolds picture. Well, those were two failed attempts. The overall summary here is granular flow is harder than fluid mechanics. That may be heresy, but it really is. And here's some of the reasons. Well, in granular flow, you have different machines with different equations. And a granular gas, like in the upper layers of the avalanche, that's a completely different set of equations from densely packed material inside it. It's the same equation for gas and liquids. And you know the equation. In granular material, we're struggling to figure out what the equation is. Second problem with granular materials is a distribution of grain sizes. At the time I was studying this, a Scientific American article came out with the title, "Why Do the Brazil Nuts Always Rise to the Top in a Mixture?" Big grain sizes tend to move up. And in the landslide, the grains go within range. And the rocks can move up. And this is very important for silos and industry because you want your product and what comes out of the silo to be uniform. If it's segregated, that's bad news. Well, our response, once again, is to put my head in the sand and say, well, I'm only going to look at the uniform grain size. Is continuum theory applicable? In fluids, the separation between the macroscale and the microscale is enormous. It's so many orders of magnitude that it's no trouble at all to accept continuum approximation, and it's extremely accurate. Whereas in granular materials, The microscale is probably in the same order of magnitude, but the microscale is particles are the order of a millimeter. So they can be bigger, but probably not much smaller. Is that enough separation scale for continuum limit to be accurate? Well, maybe. In a big coal silo, it's like 75 feet across, and the grains are perhaps. That's a few orders of magnitude, so maybe that's okay. But it is true that in granular flow, fluctuations from the average behavior are significant. Cannot be ignored. Anyway, now I'm going towards full speed ahead. I'm not going to worry about it. Microstructure. If you fill a silo by just dumping the material in, let me use a technical term, you get very different states in oil. They have different microstructures, whether it's fungus, stress chains, whatever, if you fill or dump. So my response is to wait until some flow breaks up or clumps. This is problem we talked about before, the stagnant material, the equation of stagnant material. But this comes from the fact that the flow in a granular, most of the flow in from a granular material comes from the rearrangement of grains. That's why you can deform a granular material with much smaller forces than are needed to actually deform a solid body. If you want to resolve those stagnant regions, you need something else. Perhaps you have this Mars dance and canvas. Let me strip the jungle so you've got flow everywhere. Right, consider hoppers with steep enough walls. Fluids, granular material fluids in soils, you have liquids in the intermediate interstitial region, and they have crown effect on behavior, but nonetheless, that's the form and shift of the materials. And another subtle interaction with fluid is that my Carnal collaborator, Bob Erringer, found that experiments on hoppers are hard to repeat because the ambient moisture, just the humidity on whatever day he was doing the experiment, does that change the stickiness of this material? Stickiness change. So again, my response was control the experimental environment. Or there's a new alternative now, the so-called discrete element, in which you, or molecular dynamics, in which you assume you have a lot of grains and you do a classroom mechanic problems in which you follow the interaction of every one of these grains. And you would be required or blessed with having an expert. Performing these calculations. And of course, there's no moisture issue in DEM simulations. Another problem was that it turned out that even in the dense flow region, no gas, even in the dense flow, there are multiple regimes. This is a paper, physicists discovered this, but this is a paper for Ivan. As far as less than a critical pressure or a critical density, the pressure behaves like the square of the shear rate. As far as greater, the pressure is largely independent. It depends only on the density. This is sort of like a liquid solid difference. Well, my response in 1988 is these papers haven't come out, so I wasn't triggered by it. Another problem that I mentioned was this localization of the shear bands, in which the deformation is confined to a very small region in the order of the grain scale. How do you resolve that? I didn't ignore this problem. I tried my best to capture it with the model, but I didn't really succeed. I'm going to ask you to read this. I don't want to have to say to acknowledge my stupidity out loud. So I finally left the field in disgust in 1998, 10 years after I should have seen the handwriting on the wall. I tried to sell myself as a mathematical biologist, as Tom said, for about 10 years. What? 15. Modest success, but my heart was never in it, and I never did anything all that significant. However, in the mid-80s, or sorry, in 2015, I was visiting Manchester because I had an invitation there to work on finishing up a paper that, from years earlier. And I got talking to Nico Gray, and he told me about the work of some French physicists, in which they have a constitutive law which they perform a lot of calculations with, and they seem to work. And it's a very small difference from Coulomb material. The difference is it's mu depends on R, where I is defined in terms of the shear rate, not the shear, but the shear rate. This ratio can be interpreted as the ratio of two time scales. One over count of dot, one over the shear rate is the time scale for O of one macroscopic shear rate. And this, that's the units of one over time. That's the units of time. And this describes the time for the pressure force to move a grain. The physicists are very good at constructing these dimensions, and this is more or less the only dimension of one of the things. The surprise for me is that mu was an increasing function of r, because I remember from freshman physics, kinetic friction is less than static friction. But here, when it's moving faster, apparently you get more friction. And based this on experiments. Can't argue with it. Well, this was so similar to Coulomb material that Nico and Tom and others at Manchester asked, can this be well posed? It's so similar to the case of Vanilla cut pose. Turned out we could attack the same question with the same, attack the question with the same methods. Will you give me the suggestion? Yeah. So in this paper, we found that yes, the equations are well posed for an intermediate rate of deformation if the this function, the friction function, mu of y, has this shape, the well posed region in R space. Delta mu is the separation between these two asymptotes. The well posed region, the median values are large values of I as a dimensionless shear rate, large values of I as well posed, low values, and then again as well posed. Why were they able to calculate and get answers? Well, it's a phenomenon we talked about. With coarse grid, you don't really excite the growing modes. And to be fair, these are complicated problems. It's expensive to refine your grid.
I'll skip this.
Then we asked the question, hey, we've got almost got well posing this. Can we get it for all deformation rates? And the answer turned out to be yes. And we constructed a theory called CIDR, compressible high dependent rheology. Reference, we added compressibility, so that we need a phi and we need the compatibility equation. And two of the equations were modified. We had a more general yield condition, and we had a filter. Both of these resemble critical state soil mechanics. And what we found is for CIDR, the dynamic equations are well posed, provided we have these relations. First, this combination of derivatives should be equal. And this was later interpreted by Goddard and Lee to be something called outside of symmetry. And then we need those two inequalities.
And here
are examples of two choices of the yield function in the flow group, which give you this satisfy this well behaved condition. One is the yield condition is simply moving by, and then the flow function is a function constructed from yield by an averaging process. And then with a function of density divided by R, this function of the density becomes a steady state. Solid fracture with a function of I and psi is an inverse. And this is the paper in which we, well, it's not, wasn't quite this model, but it was similar. And then in the earlier paper of the society, we constructed a real surface. So which is rather like the critical state soil mechanics. And this also worked about. So let me abandon British standard for climate.
Yes! That was the damn problem that I was working with and couldn't solve in the 90s. 25 years, but I nailed the bastard. Or we nailed the bastard.
It's a nice way to round out a career. And it hasn't completely quite rounded out. I've got two more slides, which I will not bother you with about current research. So, thanks.
Thanks a lot, Dave. It was excellent and very exciting, especially towards the end. Any questions from the audience here or online as well? Oh, yeah. Hi, Tim.
Hi. Thanks, David. Sorry I can't be with you this afternoon. I'm not feeling too well, but I have a couple of questions for you.
Please.
Very early in your talk, you gave a couple of equations for the stress. So you've got a reduced stress system, starting with three, getting down to two equations. Have you worked with characteristic variables?
No, I haven't really.
Okay. And the second question I had related to the modified incompressibility condition, div u is equal to f times gamma dot.
Mm-hmm.
So the form of the function f, mm-hmm. Does that have to satisfy a compatibility condition?
It did, and that was back a couple slides.
Yes.
Yes. The equation near the bottom.
Yes, I can see now.
F is supposed to be related to y in that way.
Yes. Okay, good. Thank you.
And as I said, that's turns out to be what's called Onsager symmetry. We didn't know that at the time, but that appeared later.
Thank you.
In critical state soil mechanics, they have a similar relation between the functional forms, which they call normality.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a subset of this condition?
No, I think it's more or less the same story.
It's a similar story, yeah, from a different point of view, I guess. Yeah.
Different notation. But I think if you really trace it out, it turns out to be almost
the same. Of course, they don't have inertial number dependence, so maybe they just have, I think they have f is dy dp by dy, dy right. By dp.
So no inertial dependence, you stretch out those terms.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'll take a question. So,
please.
Some point mentioned that you were concerned about the geometry. I saw some last
slide,
so if you can say
something
about that.
Well, I'd be glad to.
We have time.
Oops.
Yeah. So how to extend these three dimensions? And that's needed if you're going to capture the effective side loads. So the key idea was to determine the constitutive gauss from the yield condition, from this finite reality, which is relative density of the function of R, and on-target symmetry. And it's the characterization of on-target symmetry, which involves differential geometry. Since I have material objectivity, it's nice to work with diagonal matrices. Matrices are simultaneously diagonalizable. Symmetric and simultaneously diagonalizable because of the alignment condition. So let me look at sigma b with sort of stresses and strain rates in the space of diagonal matrices and three-dimensional matrices. That's a six-dimensional space. And I make it a symplectic space by symplectic form. These are the differentials. Am I hitting familiar territory or should I? Oh, okay, great. The constituent hole defines a three-dimensional setup of submanifold, namely the set of sigma b, where sigma is given by the appropriate function of b, just diagonal ones. And the differential geometry says that the constituent relation of on-Zagros symmetric, which is defined in this way, the intimate of the branch in the manifold. That's now, the yield condition, that defines a five-dimensional surface in this space, namely the stresses and the strain rates, which satisfy the yield condition. And you have one of these yield collaborators into showed that this situation, having a Lagrangian manifold in a surface implies that there's a set of ordinary differential equations such that M is the union of the trajectories of this ordinary differential equation. And then the reality, provides initial conditions for the ordinary differential equation and tells you which of the solutions of the
ODE is kind of Hamilton, applying Hamilton's equations to this specific.
So you're somehow parametrizing this Lagrangian submanifold using phase function. So mechanical transform.
I don't think it's a phase function. I know what you're talking about. One of the places where I wandered around before that you can back in the flow. Even with that background, this was quite new to me. As a result of having a Lagrangian manifold, which is contained in the surface, something with codimension one, implies that you guys assume these trajectories. This is a general situation. Having a Lagrangian manifold contained in some other submanifold means that you have a set of differential equations that describe it. Often they're over. But this is not a codimension one, you have another determinant set of the equation, and it gets into very murky water. But in this case, where the supermanifold has codimension one, with just ordinary differential equations, and no other determinants.
But the Lagrangian submanifold was half the dimension,
right?
Being the union of trajectory of ODEs reminds me very much what happens in the singularity of equation. Singularities are usually propagates along the Lagrangian submanifold. This is what I'm thinking about.
Yeah, actually, I should be careful when I say that. But I don't see the connection. I don't see how to make that connection. So I should be more cautious. It's going to be isolated.
should send our manuscript to Matteo for some ideas.
Great,
excellent. We got Thomas Blinkinsop on here as well. Okay. For a question. Hi, thanks very much for that talk, David. I was just wondering if the CIDR approach will allow you to include fluids in future modeling more readily.
That's something we need to look into. I'm not sure. I've been exclusively focused on granular material. I haven't been thinking about fluid, and Tom Barker has convinced me that we ought to think about fluids as well as granular materials. So good question, but I can't answer. I don't think I have very much to say intelligent about it at this moment.
Okay. Well, thank you. Anyway.
Maybe Tom does.
Well, yeah. Hi. We have adapted the CIDR approach for suspensions. So where the particles are fully immersed in a viscous Newtonian fluid. In fact, David is a co-author on the paper that has been submitted to
Very
review.
Very generous inclusion.
So yes, there is work in progress for fully saturated suspensions using a very similar framework. But yeah, that's work in progress. And I would like to as well look at partially wetted systems in the future as well. So we'll see where that takes us. Okay, thanks very much. It would be very interesting to talk to you a little bit more about that from my perspective as a geologist. We've been thinking about granular flows as a sort of rheology in faults, stimulated by the idea that the fault might contain a granular material with a fluid in it, and the sort of behavior you might get out of that granular flow might explain the great variety of different types of motion we get on faults in the Earth's crust. So that would be really quite exciting to see if that could be applied to that scenario. Sounds very promising.
Are you by any chance going to this meeting that Jim Sun is organizing in Edinburgh next Monday?
No. I didn't even know about it. Oh dear.
Okay, shucks. Because I'm leaving town tomorrow, I would like very much to learn more about this. I'll have to do it through Tom.
Maybe we can set up a Zoom meeting at some point to discuss these things. That would be quite nice. I would like that very much. It'd be great.
It'd be a pleasure. I'd like that too.
Yeah. Let's schedule that.
Okay. I'm an old-fashioned guy, and I don't think of Zoom right off the top of my head.
Okay. Well, thanks. If we could do that, that'd be super.
Wonderful.
Okay. Well, looks like we've got no more questions in person or online. So yeah, let's thank David again.
Thank you.
And there will be time for discussion over biscuits and tea now in the common room. So thanks everyone for online attending as well. And we'll see you next week for our final talk of the season, which is online. Roberto Sabino from the University of Vienna. See you all then. Bye for now.
I'm waiting to use online until you can get online cookies.